Well, welcome everybody. At the end of our short presentation today, I hope everyone gets a better idea of what exactly you can do with machine vision, specifically Balif machine vision. Some successes we've had in the market with our product and just general applications, how they're solved with machine vision, no matter what product you choose. So today we're going to cover what our hardware and software offering looks like, successes we've had with them, and then we're going to jump into an actual live demo of the software. So my camera is actually strategically placed to catch some of me and some of my desk. So where my hands, getting bright here is where we're going to be looking at and throwing a couple random objects on my desk under the camera and playing with some of the cockpit tools. So let's jump into it. This is our product offering. So this is the Balif Vision Solution, the BVS line. And what you're looking at is the vision controller, this black box here, our industrial cameras, quote unquote dumb cameras. So they talk to a controller. They're reliant on some type of device to do the heavy lifting or running the actual software on the back end. We have the smart camera, which is this guy down here in the bottom. That's what I lovingly call the Swiss Army knife of machine vision, because there's a lot of really cool tools you can pull out if you want them. If not, they're there. It makes projects much more interesting and less intimidating when you have those tools to back you up, whether you use them or not. And then on this tablet here is basically a screenshot of our software, which is really the meat and potatoes of our vision offering. We have some really impressive algorithms and really easy to use interfaces that are just industry leading. So I always like to point that out. Here's another look at those same products, but I'll show you kind of what makes us unique. So this is all of them, right? So we solve all these solutions with industrial cameras ranging from 1.6 megapixel to 12, and our smart camera is a 1.3 megapixel sensor. So the ability to go after like ID only or lower level vision opportunities and multiple camera, high speed, high resolution opportunities with this small product offering gives us that scalability. And what we see is customers love that because the scope's always creeping, the project's always evolving. And with us, we don't just give you the exact camera to solve the solution today. We're able to provide a camera that grows with your application. Ease of use, you'll see that in the live demo. Our software has wizards built into some tools. It's very intuitive. And this software is covered over all of our products. So no matter what camera you're choosing, it'll be interfacing with cockpit. Powerful software. So that's the segue into cockpit. Our algorithms are impressive. Some other vision manufacturers really, market and try to, spin their algorithms by giving them fancy names and stuff. We just have the power and we don't need to give them a fancy name. So you'll see that in the live demo. And then increased throughput. One of the truly unique things to Balif Vision is no matter if you're using a smart camera, this guy in the bottom, right? The Swiss Army knife, I call it, or the vision controller, you can do either Ethernet TCP and or Profinet slash Ethernet IP. So you have a field bus there and you have a more of a maybe a server friendly network to utilize, where you can segregate data, you can keep maybe your images off of a plant floor network or whatever. If you want to do it all in one cable, you can. But again, there's that tool you can take advantage of if need be. So that's the four differentiators of us against the other guys. So let's see it in action. We're going to jump into some success stories, and these are all going to be kind of vanillaized. We took some, obviously, company names out of it, but these are actual real-world applications that we've solved with our vision system, and I'll explain why we won compared to the other guys. This one here is a automotive interior trim application where they're looking for, I believe, the proper trim placed in like the blank of the door panel. And with on top of that, they're also hoping to get XY coordinates for a pick and place. And then cherry on top, we're also able to measure the trim gap. Wasn't even part of the application. It was just something they were able to take advantage of, because we solved it with our smart camera, where others try to solve it with a vision sensor. Vision sensors have a ceiling. You know, you kind of run into you stretch them as far as you can, and you run into that switching point where you really need something more powerful, and that's where a smart camera shines. So they weren't able to do it with a vision sensor they're testing. They played with our smart camera, red ring light, 60 millimeter lens, and they're up and running. So able to do three things all in the same inspection. This next one is an engine assembly. And again, the customer names are totally, taken out. So basically, I just call it by the industry. But this application, they were wanting to do a couple things. And again, because of our power and our impressive ring light, we were able to solve it in addition to what they're looking for, but also add to the application. So they were trying to solve this cotter pin and O-ring placement with a vision sensor. The incorporated ring light just wasn't powerful enough. It just wasn't giving the illumination they needed. We were able to brighten it up, and even with low light at a distance, our algorithms were able to pull out that contrast they're looking for. So again, when that vision sensor can't do it and you need that next step up, that's really what the smart camera is. It's a full vision system, not a vision sensor. So here we were able to run three inspections at once, testing different locations, providing detail and measurement back to the customer, and then obviously kick out a reject. Here's a plastics or pharmaceutical application. This one was tricky. So they had a bunch of errors they wanted to detect at the same time. So it wasn't just a, hey, is this date code here? Hey, is my seal correct? Hey, do I have fluid in the vial? It was all of them at once. So this one, we stepped up from the smart camera to our controller, that black box, and some of our industrial cameras. We used a 12 megapixel industrial Gigi interface camera, a white ring light, and we also utilized our Balif HMI. So we have a little touchscreen that interfaces the cockpit where you can actually see the results. So this was an awesome application. Again, showing me successful doing several things at once with a kind of a tricky part, you know, a clear fluid and a clear plastic and a small size. Here's one in the electronics. It's technically automotive, but I would liken this to an electronics application. This is the back of an infotainment system. So like the back of your touchscreen or your navigation system in a car. This is at a facility that makes these and ships them to the actual automotive customer. And it's very important you get those cable connectors seated correctly, because once it's in the dash, it's a bear to get out and replace. So they have to make sure everything's seated correctly before it goes into the actual cluster. So they were trying to solve this with a low level vision sensor. They could kind of get it. It was iffy at best. We strapped our smart camera to the machine, our infrared ring light and a 20 millimeter lens. We were able to not only detect the presence and this proper seating of that clip, but also others. So again, while you have our camera in front of your application, what else can you throw at it? We can usually handle it. This one here started off as an RFID application. They're trying to track different types of tire rims. And they actually have a 2D printed code on the rim. So they're like, well, why don't we just catch it with our vision system? We can measure the rim and measure the characteristics of the rim to tell you what it is. And then we can read the code to double check our math. So that's what we're doing in this application. We're reading a 2D code and grading it, by the way, deciphering between different wheel types and then inspecting the wheel for defects. Might as well do a quality check while you're at it. This one we're able to solve with a smart camera. Again, that's that 1.3 megapixel. Great opportunity, and we're able to do a lot more than what they expected. So that should give you some ideas of what we can do in the field with our hardware and software. So I'm going to let you see it in action. So I'm going to actually share my screen, and you should be able to see a cockpit now. So this here is the interface to our cameras. And as you can tell, it's through a web browser. So I'm actually contacting the camera through a web address locally to my computer. So if a smart camera, if you worry about what laptop has the software on it or something like that, with maybe the vision systems you're using currently, There's no need to do that with cockpit. Smart camera, it's all embedded. It lives within the camera itself. You just access it through a web address. So here we are, we're live. I'll run my hand under the screen there so you can see that this is actually a live image of my desk. I'm shooting at the back of a mouse pad, just a nice solid black background. And what we'll do is we'll run through some of our tools and just solve out some applications on some devices on my desk quick. So over here on the left, you'll see our tool pane. So this is basically how you stack tools. You can build off one another, all that good stuff. And by the way, we're in configuration mode. There's monitoring, configuration, statistics. Monitoring is more like run mode. Statistics is kind of trends, and you can look for soft alarms and stuff like that. Maybe something's slowly going out of spec, but it's not failed yet. It'll let you know. But let's stay in configuration because that's really what we're going to be doing today. We're going to be writing a program or two or three. So this will go fast because, again, the ease of use, our powerful software that is extremely intuitive. Our tools have wizards in them. That's when you see a tool with a little magic wand there, that's what that means. And it steps you through the process. It keeps you out of trouble, but no worries. You can dig down in the weeds if you want. So I'll show you some of that in action. So I always like to start a program with a find object, okay? You're always going to have a setup camera and get image. That's basically just communicating to your camera, get images, care about what I see, and you go from there. So let's do a find object tool. So I have this little cleaning brush I found in my desk drawer today. I figured we can do some measurements on and we can track it, all that good stuff. So within this tool, if I start clicking the next arrow, I start jumping to the next set of parameters I got to set or teach. So here I can name it. We'll skip that today. I can catch the background. I don't care, but I do care about the image. So go out, look, tell me what you see. So I'm going to delete all this. I'm only interested in something unique about the part. This is essentially going to find that contrast, that pattern I'm painting, and then look for it. So I don't want to necessarily do something that's, cylindrical or something that's uniform. You rotate it 360 because then it won't ever offset anything. So this is pretty definitive. So it thanks and it looks for those edges and it defines them. You see the blue, or excuse me, the green lines there. And we can finish the wizard, the kind of walkthrough. We can make this area of interest a little bigger, make sure the camera's looking at more places for it. And right now, if I just move it around, it's going to find it. This isn't that impressive. But if it's not in the box, it doesn't find it. If it is in the box, it finds it, right? Even with a little rotation and a little in and out, up and down. Now, this tool is super powerful because you can literally just have this tool and have a lot of information. So you get the XY coordinates, you get displacement, rotation, degree of match, center of gravity. So all this is just off of this find object tool. Not only are you getting that information, you're verifying that the object's there and you can count how many. So maybe there's several of these brush heads coming through. You can actually give a count as well, all from this tool. So we have a find object tool, but now we can build off that. We can take advantage of the power of that and we can put it to work on another tool. So let's do a measurement. Again, super easy measure object here. Again, we're in a wizard. It's going to step us through. It basically wants to capture a reference image. Let's just see what we can measure here. It goes out, it thinks, looks for nice, crisp, definitive edges. It can decipher between pixels. Found some here. I'm going to measure the radius of that. Click next, finish wizard. Now I can move this around and my tool will follow wherever that object is because I set up that find object tool. So now, there we go. So now I'm moving it around, you see, and it's jumping around like crazy if it can find it. And if it does, it puts that measurement tool on top. So again, it gives us movement, it gives us rotation, all on the fly. So what else can we do? I'll show you the check object tool. That's pretty cool and fast. So if you ever wanted to use a tool that was kind of a go, no go, or a good part, bad part, and sometimes we refer to it as, the check object tool is awesome. But again, I always like to put a find object tool first. So let's do that. Let's find this pen. Again, we can name it under the background. Let's just skip that. We give it a unique feature. That clip's kind of unique. It goes out and looks for it, finds it, we like it, and I want you to look anywhere in this box for it. Okay, now we have find object. So now we can just verify the pen's clips there. That's all we wanted to do, but I want to tell if that cap is up or down. If the cap's down, I want to kick it out. I don't want to put that in the pen box. I want the cap up, just preserve ink or something, you know, whatever it may be. So let's do a check object. Again, run a wizard, just gonna go fast. Essentially, you teach it a good element. The cap's up now, so let's just call that good. And you teach it a bad element. Okay. And you give it the area to care about. That's really the only thing we changed. And it goes out and it thinks. It compares the good you taught it, the bad you taught it, and it gives you a good threshold. So in a second here, the cap is, we better finish the wizard. Cap is down, so we failed. See down here, it says failed tool processing. If I get in there and put it back up, it is successful, right? So good part, bad part. Super easy, super quick, on the fly, being able to adjust a good part, bad part solution. And let's see, we got a little time. So I think I got enough time to do a barcode for you quick. Barcode, you don't need a find object because it's going to find that barcode no matter what the rotation is, as long as you have it set that way. So let's show you how we do that. Let's all pretend on this call, nobody knows anything about barcodes. And my manager tells me I need to find this barcode and identify it and give me a grade and tell me what it says. So the tool, again, is a wizard, so it's going to go fast. We look for a code. It finds it, puts a little purple box around it. We train it, and we can search for another one if we wanted to, but it's not. We finish wizard, and now we're getting not only what the code is, over here in our code type, it tells us. We're also getting the location of that barcode. So if we wanted to offset some type of pick and place, if we want to make sure it's in the right spot, we got all that data, the rotation. But this is another cool thing. We can actually grade it. So if I put assess quality down here under code quality, if you can see this part down here, right now it's reading all A's. It's a really good black on white code. But check it out. I can still make it become an F and still read it, of course, but I'm making it like not ideal. And I can spit that out to my customer. So I can say, hey, you know, if you only want to see B codes or above, I can prove that now. And with that, I think I will pass it on back over to Chris.
Great. Thank you, Logan. Thank you for that demo there. And so right now we're going to go ahead and move to our question and answer session. So Logan, I have a couple of questions that came in through the chat. If anybody else has any questions, please be sure to enter those in the chat right now, and we'll address those right now. So we have a question here. Are there any applications over a larger area? I guess I think this person is asking, is there a way to, I guess we were showing the pen and showed a small area. Can it look for larger area for that kind of thing?
Oh, yeah, of course. So out of convenience, I keep the camera within arm's length, you know, so I usually show it on my desk, but I'm going to back up on the PowerPoint, you know, like this wheel inspection, you know, it was like 6 feet away from the wheel of the tire itself, you know, so the fact that we have a C-mount lens option or vision sensors, they just give you that incorporated little lens. There's really not much you can do with it outside of like the 4 or 5 foot range. We can get creative with our lensing and we can be way back. I mean, now it's just a matter of, if we have the right lens and if we've illuminated the part enough to get that light back to the camera. But yeah, several applications that we're involved in currently and that we've solved in the past are, you know, 8, 10, 12 feet back from the part itself. So no worries there.
Okay. Thank you, Logan. Hopefully that answered your question there. And we have another question. Would you say that these software tools allow a camera to be set up and integrated by a user without significant prior vision experience?
Yeah. So the beauty of Cockpit and its wizards allows a novice or new to Cockpit, maybe they're very familiar with other software, other vision software, and they don't want to like round the corner and try something new. The beauty of Cockpit is it's built for that. It lets people, you know, kind of get in about ankle deep into the water and still be very dangerous. And then the learning curve up to like, you know, up to the neck is very easy because really you learn the basics going to the wizard. And then it's just checking a couple boxes to get into the more advanced stuff.
Okay. Thank you. We have a few more questions rolling in. And just to let everybody know, we will try to answer everybody's question here. But if we don't, if we run out of time in respect of everybody else's time, we will be sure to respond to any questions we don't get to over email. But here we have another question. What kind of data can be sent to a PLC?
So all like any of the data that comes out of the tool itself could be a variable and a part of like logic or string data that can be sent to the PLC. You can do some basic logic within Cockpit, AKA within the camera, or you can send all the data to the PLC, let that do all the heavy lifting and calculating, comparing. So really anything, you can call up programs, you can pull up execution time, XY position, percent of match, any type of integer variable you want to send there. If it's tied to a tool, if there's some way to access it within the tool itself, you can send it to the PLC. So anything you can manipulate, couldn't get to the PLC.
Is there a software available for offline simulation?
Yeah, so Cockpit does have offline simulation. You can actually use it as a file device where you can take camera images and stack tools on top of them to simulate. Maybe not, say you're expecting like a quarter panel of a vehicle. Well, they're not going to throw that in the mail and send it to me to test, but they can send me a couple pictures and I have a good part and bad part. And I can tell them what a two-dimensional image can be compared against and found within our software. So yeah, there you can program offline and you can program without a camera via the file device.
Is there user authorization for the programming interface?
There is, yeah. So you can set them all the way down to like maintenance or like guest type levels, all the way up to administrator. So you give different passwords that essentially unlock different features within Cockpit. Some don't unlock any, and you can just view the image. Others let somebody reprogram the program altogether.
Okay, we have another question here. So for grading, you are validating and not verifying in your demo. Do you have a verifier to do actual grading to the ANSI standards?
So yes and no. I mean, we can verify the barcodes there based on what it was trained and a training standard, and we can take the grading out based on the validation tool. The standards itself, I'm not exactly sure how to meet that standard, but I know there's probably a third validation involved outside of that, but usually our grading and our validating together is enough for most customers. But yes, I am aware there's a standard. I'm just not sure if we've met that exactly yet. So.